In experiment number 6, we look at classification of chemical reactions. This is maybe the hardest experiment that you'll do the whole semester. And it's a good thing you're looking at this video because I'm going to give you some real help in writing all of these chemical reactions. Part A deals with combination reactions. The general formula for a combination reaction is A plus B goes to C. That's the classic chemical reaction, isn't it? Have two starting materials, one product. And in the first part of this Part A, you'll take magnesium, which is a solid, and burn it. And anytime something burns, it combines with oxygen. And when we write a chemical equation, we want to be as accurate as we can. And so rather than just putting O down, we know that oxygen travels around as O2. Here, the small s in parentheses indicates that magnesium is a solid, the small g in parentheses that oxygen is a gas. And if you look at the calculations and report part of this experiment, toward the end of the experiment, that where it sort of reviews each part that you do and gives you tips and hints and so forth, it tells you that magnesium oxide is the product that's formed. And it's a solid. Well, we're not quite finished here. We've indicated the material that forms, and we've got the correct formula for it, magnesium oxide. The third thing and last thing that we want to do is to balance the equation. So don't forget that. And I'd like you to finish balancing this equation, but I'm going to give you some tips. If I look at magnesium, well, I've got one on each side, but two oxygens, and over here just one oxygen. An even number and an odd number on the right-hand side. They're never going to balance unless both sides have an even number of oxygens. So this tip for balancing equations is called even up the odd. Got an odd number of oxygens. How could we get an even number? Well, I can't put a 2 down there. That's changing the formula. We can only when you balance an equation, once you have correct formulas, you can only use coefficients. So I'd put the coefficient 2 in front of here. Then I'd have 2 magnesiums, 2 oxygens. Got 2 oxygens on this side. We'd have to come back and put a 2 in front of the magnesium. Let's look at Part B. In Part B, we're looking at decomposition reactions. That means something breaks apart. The general formula is A going to B plus C. In other words, one material on the left, two materials or more over on the right-hand side. And in the first part of Part B, you're working with potassium chlorate. And it's a solid, and you're heating it. And as you heat it, we get two products. And as this reaction is taking place, you put in a burning wood splint, and what you see is that the burning wood splint glows brighter. That means that oxygen is around. So oxygen is one of the products. It's in a gaseous state. And looking again back at the calculations and report page, it tells you that the other product is potassium chloride. So here we go. I've got the correct formulas. Potassium chloride, I've written oxygen as O2, but we're not quite finished yet. You'd want to balance the chemical equation because only balanced chemical equations obey the law of conservation of matter. That is, we can't create or destroy atoms. And in a sense, we're destroying some oxygen, because we've got 3 oxygens on this side, but only 2 over there. 1K, 1Cl, 1K, 1Cl. It's the oxygens that aren't balanced. Remember the rule, even up the odd. Got an odd number on the left, an even number on the right. The only way that they'll ever balance is to have an even number on both sides. I can get an even number by placing the coefficient 2 here. Then I'd have 6 oxygens, the coefficient times the subscript, I'd have six oxygens on the left. How would we get six oxygens on the right? Well, we'd have to put a three there, wouldn't we? And we've got a new number in front of that KCl as well. If we have two here, we've got to have a two in front of the KCl. So always remember, after you get the correct formulas, the very last thing you want to do, finish balancing the equation. Let's look at Part C. Part C deals with single replacement reactions. They take this form, A plus BX goes to B plus AX. I've got something all by itself. In other words, this must be an element. Here I've got a compound, and typically in compounds, we've got the metal on the left and the nonmetal or the polyatomic ion on the right. So this metal is kicking out B, and B will be all by itself. This metal is now in combination with X. That's the pattern. So now, knowing the starting materials, and you'd get those just from reading the experiment, we're starting with copper. It's a solid. It's an element. It's all by itself. It's A. Reacting that with silver nitrate. So two parts, a metal and a polyatomic ion. The copper is going to kick out the silver. So here I've got silver all by itself. And then the copper must be combined with the nitrate. So we've got copper nitrate over on the right-hand side. Now I've balanced this equation, but keep in mind that's the last step that you want to do. Well, the first thing we'd like to do is to get the correct formulas. Well, I know silver is going to be all by itself. Copper is going to be with the nitrate. How do I know that there's going to be two nitrates there? Well, the easiest way is that later on in the experiment, we're using copper nitrate in another reaction so that you see that copper has two nitrates associated with it. And the calculations and report page tells you that as well. So that's how we'd come up with the correct formula. Silver is a solid. That means it's going to settle out of the reaction. And copper nitrate will still be in solution. So it's got an aqueous there. Well, we've got correct formulas. We want to balance the equation now. And looking at the nitrates, the polyatomic ions, if I've got two on that side, I need two on this side. So we put a two in front of the silver nitrate. That changes the number of silvers. We've got two silvers there. So our equation is balanced and we're ready to go forward. This is called the molecular equation. Haven't indicated any ions. And now the next step would be to write this in total ionic form. That means that we're going to break apart everything that we've indicated is aqueous. Solids, well, they're sitting there in solution in the test tube, but they don't break apart. They're all by themselves. They can't break apart. But the other things that are indicated as aqueous, they can break apart. So we're going to break the silver nitrate apart. And silver likes to form a plus one. We could find that by looking a little later in the experiment and see that silver is a plus one. Or another way would be to know that it has to balance the nitrates. If there are two nitrates and nitrates are a minus one, then these two silvers must be a plus one to balance that. Over on the right-hand side, we'd simply repeat the silver. Nothing happens to it, so there it is, but we'll break apart the copper nitrate. Again, nitrate is a minus one, and this subscript tells us that there are two of those. So we get two nitrates. Well, if there are two minuses, the copper must be a two plus to balance that. So here's the total ionic equation. We've broken everything apart that was in aqueous form. We've left everything intact that was a solid. And the third step, and the last step, is to write the net ionic equation. We take the total ionic equation and look for spectator ions. Spectator ions are there. They're just watching things happen. They don't change. And on the left, I see I've got two nitrates. Over on the right-hand side, two nitrates in exactly the same form. They're the only spectator ions. Everything else changes. You could say, well, I've got copper on the left and I've got copper on the right. That's true. I've got silver on the left and silver on the right, but they're in different forms. Here the silver is ionic, a plus one. Over here, it's neutral. So nitrates will subtract out, and what we're left with is this equation. Copper plus silver ions goes to solid silver and copper ions. A net ionic equation is sort of a generic equation. It means that copper and any source of silver ion are going to give us metallic silver. So I could use any kind of silver solid that would compound that would dissolve. Silver nitrate dissolves well, or silver sulfate or other silver compounds, they'd all give us the same net ionic reaction. Let's look at part D. In part D, we're looking at double replacement reactions. These take the form of AX plus BY gives AY plus BX. Two compounds, and they just sort of partner swap. The metal in this compound takes the place of the metal in that compound, and vice versa. Well, our starting materials for the first part of this experiment in part D, copper nitrate and sodium hydroxide. And then if we're going to switch places, the copper for the sodium, that means that we'll end up with copper hydroxide and sodium nitrate. Well, the very first step is predicting the products over here. Let's take sodium nitrate first. I know that nitrate is a minus one. Sodium's in group 1A, and it likes to form a plus one ion. So sodium nitrate is the right formula, NaNO3. But copper hydroxide, how do I know that there's two OHs there? Well, a couple of ways. There's some information in the experiment within the text. There's a table of polyatomic ions, and hydroxide is there, and it's a minus one. And in the experiment today, we've learned that copper likes to be a plus two. So if copper is a two plus, there has to be two OH minuses to balance that copper two plus. So I've got the correct formulas. Now we're going to balance the equation. Over here I've got two nitrates. Well, I need two nitrates on that side. So that's where the coefficient two comes from. And if I have two sodiums over there, then I need two sodiums on this side. So again, putting the two in front of NaOH does that for us. Then we could see that everything else balances. Two OHs, two OHs, and so on. So remember, predict the products, get correct formulas, and then balance the equation. Here's the total molecular equation. I shouldn't use total, molecular equation. Now let's do the total ionic. Well, all of the starting materials were aqueous. One of the solids that forms in this part D, we predict, is copper hydroxide. And you'll find that to be the case when you look at the photos. That solid means that it's sitting there on the bottom of the test tube, most likely. And if it's insoluble, then it can't break apart. It's ionic, but if it's insoluble, it can't break apart into ions. So we simply bring it down, we repeat it down here. Copper hydroxide, it's in solid form, but will break apart everything else that's aqueous. The copper likes to be 2 plus. We have two nitrates, each one is a minus 1. Breaking the sodium hydroxide apart, two Na pluses, two OH minuses. Over on the right hand side, going to leave that solid alone just as it is. but we'll break apart the sodium nitrate to get Na plus and NO3 minus. And remember to keep that equation balanced as you go down. Here's the total ionic equation. Let's look for the spectator ions. Well, I see nitrate here and nitrate over there, so it's a spectator. I also see sodium ions, two Na pluses on the left and on the right. They're spectators. Let's take those out of the equation. What we have left is the net ionic equation. Copper aqueous combines with hydroxide aqueous to give a solid copper hydroxide. A precipitate will form. And again, it's sort of a generic equation. It means that any soluble form of copper ion, if we react it with any soluble form of hydroxide, like sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, magnesium hydroxide, any soluble hydroxide, we're going to get a precipitate.